He was the world's best marathoner, a four-time Olympian and Australia's first world athletics champion.
It was a wonderful period of my life. I was really very, very lucky. I trained hard and I, you know, earned everything. Every win, every record came out of sweat and hard work and determination.
The running legend is now scouring the nation for Australia's first Indigenous Olympic marathon runner.
I'd love to find a middle distance and a distance runner. And maybe it'll be one of her women.
But his Indigenous marathon project isn't just about finding the next Olympic superstar.
We're really just using the marathon and using running as a way to identify some incredible young Aboriginal and Island men and women, and then to help them on their journey to get them to be leaders and make a really significant contribution to improving a lot of the challenges that Australia faces in Indigenous health and wellbeing.
There's 32 of us that have finished a marathon, an international marathon, and that's 32 stories, and it just keeps getting bigger and better every year.
The Australian icon is concerned about the state of Indigenous affairs.
We're a wonderful, beautiful, rich, exciting country, but unfortunately, when you look at the gap in life expectancy and education and a lot of the other social measures, it's a very, very dark, sad, gloomy situation for Australia.
For him to actually have time for us Indigenous people and, you know, take us to New York and experience something. It's not all about being running a marathon, it's being a better person.
Find out how my guest on Living Black Conversations, the legendary Robert D. Castella, has mentored over 30 Indigenous runners to compete in the New York Marathon and become role models in their respective communities. Rob, welcome to Living Black Conversations.
Thank you. Thanks, Carla.
Well, you've represented Australia at four Olympics. You're a two-time Commonwealth gold medalist, and you were voted the world's best marathon runner in the 1980s. As the driving force behind the Indigenous Marathon Project, how long do you think it will be until you unearth Australia's first Indigenous Olympic marathon runner?
Well, it's a good question. I mean, we've certainly, over the last 4 or 5 years, have seen, I think, some runners with the talent or the natural running ability to be champions. The difficulty is a lot of them come from far north Queensland and the Northern Territory, and the conditions through the wet season and the really, you know, sort of hot climate makes it really difficult to do the consistent training. We don't really want to encourage them necessarily to move away from home and family, especially when they are such significant contributors to the community. So, I'm sure it'll happen one day. It's not the primary goal of IMP. I mean, we're really a health promotion charity, and we're really just using the marathon and using running as a way to identify some incredible young Aboriginal and Island men and women, and then to help them on their journey to get them to be leaders and make a really significant contribution to improving a lot of the challenges that Australia faces in Indigenous health and wellbeing.
So how did the Indigenous Marathon Project come about?
I was contacted back in 2009 by a guy who has an advertising production company, Matt Long, up in Sydney. And Matt had always wanted to do a documentary. And his brother had just run a marathon, and Matt himself had run the City of the Surf in Sydney a couple of times. So, Matt came up with this idea to see whether he could do a documentary, getting a group of Aboriginal men from central desert Australia, see whether you could train them for a period of time, take them to a marathon, New York, and whether they, you know, sort of did show those natural running abilities that maybe some of the Africans have. And that was really the start of it.
Why are you so passionate about Indigenous runners?
If I can make a little bit of a difference and identify some people and put them into a position where they can contribute, then I think, you know, not only is it something that I want to do, but it's also something I feel as though I have to do.
What do you think sets Indigenous runners apart from the rest?
We've got a guy up in Ramanginning, up in East Arnhem Land, who you know, you could put him alongside a Kenyan world record holder, and their physique and their physiology and their running ability and technique and style is almost, you know, one for one. So I think that there is some incredible natural physical talents and abilities out there, but ability is only a very small part of it. A lot of it has to come down to drive and commitment and determination. And I think that's where I've seen a lot of the natural strength of our Indigenous men and women. It's a determination to achieve, not for themselves. I mean, obviously the chance to go to New York City and you know, go to Times Square and the Empire State Building and all these things is very attractive, but it's more about an obligation that they feel to making a difference as well. You know, they're representing not just themselves but their families, their communities. They're inspiring their brothers and sisters and cousins and nephews to get out there and to change their life. You know, it's not a good situation when we have so much incarceration and so much crime within Indigenous communities. It's not a good situation to see the incidence of youth suicide and alcohol and violence and all of the other tags. And I feel that what drives a lot of our runners is a belief that they can actually make a difference, that they can ensure that their children and their little nephews and cousins don't end up as a statistic.
I remember the last 200 metres where you go through Central Park and you've got all the different flags from different countries and it hits you home, you know, you start to think about why you're doing it and you think about, you know, well, I thought about my grandparents and my mum and dad and my family, and it kind of makes you feel good. You know how close you are, and you know, just feeling really, really proud. And it was just one of those moments that no one can take it away from you. You've done something really big and something I'm still to this day am so proud of.
You know, when you struggle at some stage, I was struggling at some stage and it just pulled through. And
the marathon is one of the hardest things that you can do. It's a goal a lot of people have, running a marathon on their bucket list of things that they want to do before they die, just because it's one of those ultimate challenges. But on the other hand, you know, it's not that complicated. You know, like, you know, you just get out there and you just put your left foot in front of your right foot and you just keep on going. So it's not, you know, it's not really a complicated thing to do, but it is one of the most physical and emotional challenges that you'll ever do in your life. Our runners do that off 7 months of training. A lot of them have never done any running before, but for them to come out and put their hand up and say, I'll give it a go, it's an incredible testament to their belief in themselves, their family's belief in them. And when they do cross the finish line in Central Park in New York City, for me to be on the finish line when they run across is just one of the most amazing experiences of my life. You know, I've been with them through their entire journey, and I've seen and worked with them through some of the challenges and issues that they've had to get through, and then to be there when they're physically absolutely spent, there's nothing left, they're physically exhausted, but emotionally charged and overflowing with pride and excitement and it's that, you know, sort of that mix of exhaustion and emotional excitement which is just an incredible thing to witness, and the tears of pride that they shed, and we all, you know, cry together because it's just such an incredible experience.
It is a very emotional journey for the girls and guys who do participate in it. I remember, you know, tagging along with you in 2011 and speaking to the runners on the bus going up to, you know, to the start line, and just how they were reflecting on their family back home. And yeah, it wasn't just about, you know, being there in New York and buying souvenirs. It was more than that. It was thinking about everyone back home and how they were feeling, and they really wanted to do it for them.
Yeah, look, absolutely, Carla. I mean, in 2010, when we had those first group of four guys running, most of them hadn't done enough training. You know, I knew it was going to be really, really hard for them to just, you know, get through that last bit. So on the starting line, I took each of them aside, and I asked them one by one, separately, you know, why are you here? Why are you doing this? And every one of them gave me exactly the same answer. And they hadn't been talking to each other, but they gave me exactly the same answer. They said, I'm here for my family. And I had this black permanent marker, and I wrote family on the back of their hand. And I said to them, when you get to 30 kilometers and you want to quit, you look down and remember why you're here. And every one of them looked up at me in my eyes, and I could tell by the look in their eyes that there was no way that any of them were going to not finish, because it was all about family. And that was a great, it was a, you know, responsibility. It was a great duty and something which they took on incredibly seriously.
I've always written family on my hand, my left hand, so, you know, that gets me through. My family and my extended family we're a very close family, and, you know, now I've got a family of my own, my wife and my young daughter and my son as well. So, you know, they help me, you know, keep me going. When it gets really tough, when my body shuts down and, you know, you want to stop, I just look at my hand and just push through the pain, and just I never give up, and, you know, eventually you make it to the finish line.
It's a difficult task for anyone, and, you know, for elite athletes to run a marathon. But how challenging is it, do you think, for young Indigenous people from remote communities who, you know, have possibly never run? As you've said, a lot of them have not had that experience of running before. They've never run more than a couple of k's. So, you know, how challenging is it for them to do something of this magnitude, do you think?
It is almost impossible. You know, you ask someone to train for 6 or 7 months to run a marathon, not doing any running, and they'd laugh. You ask them to do it from some of the most remote and sometimes inhospitable places on the planet, which is in, you know, part of remote Arnhem Land and up in far north Queensland, and you know, it's mind-boggling.
To date, how successful has the IMP been, and how has it changed the lives of your protégés?
We're seeing huge, you know, statistics, you know, great improvements in terms of employment and our runners going on and doing incredible things. We're seeing our little remote, our deadly fun runs growing in terms of popularity and participation numbers. So all of those healthy lifestyle messages are getting through. People are being more physically active, they're eating and drinking better, drinking more water, getting off all of the rubbish soft drink and sugar drinks and stuff that are killing everyone. They're reducing their risk-taking behaviour, they're managing alcohol, they're getting off the tobacco, getting off the ganja. You know, all of these things we're seeing happening through the communities.
All the way!
Nice work. I'm an ambassador now, so just for me to help spread the word about IMP. You know, I suppose living in Alice Springs, it's tough. There's a lot of negative things more than positive things in Alice Springs. So, you know, I want to make a change in my community to change, you know, the culture of living and that kind of thing. There's a lot of drinking in Alice Springs and that kind of thing. So, just being a positive role model in Alice Springs, it's very important to me. I know I lead by example and others look up to me, and you know, I know it's important for me to keep involved with the project and, you know, spreading the word around.
Well, Nadine Hunt made history of becoming the first Indigenous Australian woman to cross the finish line of the New York Marathon in 2011. How did it feel to see Nadine making history?
Oh, look, it was great, and you know, Nadine's an Aboriginal island woman from far north Queensland, who, when we first met Nadine, you know, she was young and you know, beautiful and bubbly and just, you know, sort of getting out there like a lot of teenagers are, and just enjoying life with no real sense of purpose or direction. And Nadine, you know, now works, she's moved from North Queensland, from Cairns down here to Canberra, works full time with us, has developed and now delivers our Cert 4 to all of our runners. And she also coordinates all of our deadly fun runs in the remote and regional community. So the impact that she's having is just incredible.
My whole family from Cairns, you know, make the effort to drive up to Mossman and participate in a deadly fun run. And my pop, you know, he's lost both of his legs to diabetes. And, you know, they pick him up and put him in the car. And my uncle, you know, pushes him through the fun run just so he can participate and be involved with something, and it's their way of supporting me. And so, you know, by starting the fun runs, it's for me, it's good to get a message, or my sister would send me a photo with all my family, you know, my grandma, pa, everyone, you know, all my cousins with their finishers medal, you know, standing there so proud.
Well, as you've been saying, this isn't just about making it to New York. It's more than that. The athletes are doing something for themselves, you know, getting a great sense of achievement, and it's having an impact on their families and their communities. But what does Rob De Castella get out of it?
I am so privileged to have an opportunity to work with some amazing young Aboriginal and Torres Strait Island men and women that are going to make a difference to Australia. You know, I think all of us want to make a difference. All of us want to look back over our life and feel as though we've made a contribution, and you know, hopefully the place is a little bit better for us having been here. And for me, you know, that's what IMP is giving me a chance to do. You know, I had a great life as an athlete. You know, I travelled the world and lived in the US for 5 years, and you know, won world championships, Australian of the Year, all sorts of great things. But I really believe that, you know, IMP is the most important thing I've ever done, because it is making a difference to Australia in a really important area. We as a nation cannot reconcile ourselves with what's happening if we don't do something with Indigenous Australia.
Well, your father ran marathons at 59 years of age. How was he an influence on your running career?
Oh, look, my dad was the person who got me running at the very, very start. You know, I was 13 or 14, and I'm the eldest of seven kids, and my dad decided he wanted to get fit, and dragged me out at, you know, 6 o'clock in the morning down in Melbourne, running through the back streets of the suburbs, and I used to hate it, but my dad was my number one supporter, my number one fan, a confidant. We'd train together, we'd go to races together. He was an incredible positive influence on my running, and even I think on my life. Mum was an incredible influence as well. I mean, she was really, like a lot of mothers, the rock that held the family together. Dad was the eccentric, and Mum was the thing that held things solid. They supported me absolutely 100%. And even when I was representing Australia and making a good living out of my running, I still remember Mum coming up to me and saying, "Rob, you know, when are you going to get a proper job? All this running caper, I mean, you know." So, she was always the one who would, you know, bring you back to reality and earth when your head started getting up in the stars and the clouds. So it was wonderful, you know.
How determined were you to reach the elite level of the sport?
You know, I was absolutely fanatical about my running. It was the number one thing that I did. Everything else fitted in around it. That's not to say, you know, there wasn't space for other things to fit in, but very quickly I realised that if I was going to be the best, I had to be absolutely, totally committed and dedicated, and I enjoyed it as well. I mean, I had a body or a physiology or a state that allowed me to do the training that I needed to do, and to compete and win and, you know, set world records and win world championships.
Well, you attracted international attention when you won in 1981 the Fukuoka Marathon in world record time, and from there you went on to become a world champion. What was the driving, what was driving you during that period, during the 80s?
The 80s, I guess, were my best years. That whole decade of the 80s, I think one of the big international running magazines voted me the world's best marathon runner for the decade of the 1980s. So I was really consistent. I'd made a decision that I wanted to be the best marathon runner that I could possibly be. I didn't want to look back and have any regrets. So whatever I believed I needed to do, I did.
Well, it certainly paid off because you've won so many events around the world. And you competed at the Olympics 4 times. What's been the highlight for you?
Of my running? Winning the Commonwealth Games here in Brisbane, in Australia, was huge. It's still a pretty amazing race that a lot of people still talk about, even though it was back in 1982. And that was, you know, doing it here in Australia was pretty incredible.
Yeah, he's going, yeah.
Dee Castella hits the front in the last 2 miles.
Come on, Dee.
I was, you know, over a minute behind at halfway, and to run the two Tanzanian runners down over that last 10K was just incredible.
Look at it. Yes, well done, he's won
Dee.
It.
Go, Dee.
Yes, he's won it.
What a great
he's finished.
What
wonderful
a great effort.
Race.
He's done about 2:09.
Boston was my fastest marathon. I ran 2:07:51, which is still, you know, even today, a reasonably respectable time. And smashed the course record, and it was one of those races where, you know, I felt like Superman.
Do you think we'll ever see an Indigenous Australian competing at the Olympic level?
Absolutely we will, yeah, absolutely.
How far away do you think that is?
Oh, look, it could be a while. We have to, you know, find the right person, and it could be in a couple of years, but it's more likely probably to be, you know, sort of 5 to 10 years or thereabouts. We say you're racing today off the last 4 years of training. So if we found the superstar, if we find that person, they still need to train for at least 4 years, train hard, full-on training for 4 years to get to that international level. So it'll take a while. I'd love to find a middle distance and a distance runner, and maybe it'll be one of her women.
How will you feel when Australia gets to watch its first Indigenous runner in the Olympic marathon event?
Oh, look, I'll be so proud, Carla. I'll be so proud to have sown a seed that one day, you know, turns into something that all of Australia can be so proud of. I'll be proud because I will know the impact that individual is having in terms of inspiring future generations, young Indigenous boys and girls, to get out there and run and be active and to be healthy and achieve and be proud of themselves. You know, pride is so important if you're going to make an effort to look after yourself. If you're not proud of yourself, then why would you bother looking after yourself? So we need to find ways to make and help our Indigenous people to be proud. When you're proud of yourself, you'll make an effort to give up the smokes, to get off the grog, to get a job, to stay in school, to do all of those things that are hard. It's hard work. If you feel as though you're worthless and you're not, you know, you have no value, why would you bother? So pride is what it comes down to, and self-worth. And for us to have an Indigenous Australian representing Australia in the Olympic marathon, I think is just going to send, you know, wave after wave, a tsunami of pride around Australia.